In this module, we're going to talk about standard free energy, equilibria and the relationship to free energy, and work and its relationship to free energy. So delta G0 of a reaction is the change in Gibbs free energy for a reaction under standard state conditions. What does that mean? Well, if it's a gas, it means that all the gases are at one atmosphere of pressure. If it's a liquid, it means the liquids are all pure liquids. Solids are pure solids. Elements are in their most stable form at one atmosphere and 25 degrees Celsius. And all solutions are one molar. That's what we mean by delta G0 in standard states. This is the thing you can look up. These are tabulated. Now, if you have, for a chemical reaction, you can calculate delta G0 for that reaction by looking up the delta G0s of formation of the reactants and products. It ends up that change in that Gibbs free energy works the same way that enthalpy does, and Hess's law. It looks just the same, only it's the delta G0 formation rather than the delta H0 formation. So for our generic chemical equation, AA plus BB in equilibrium with CC and DD, we have this equation describing that allows us to calculate the delta G0 of the reaction if we can look up the delta G0 formations of all the reactants and products. And remember, the little letters are the coefficients in the balanced equation. The big letters represent the formulas for the elements. So for example, in the combustion of methane, this balanced equation right here, the delta G0 of reaction would be the delta G0 formation of carbon dioxide times its coefficient, which is 1, so it's just this, plus delta G0 formation of water liquid, and the state is really important. That's going to be different for liquid than a gas, for instance, times 2, because the coefficient is 2, minus the delta G0 formation of the reactants. Now, there's methane, CH4, its coefficient is 1. Notice I didn't write oxygen down here. That's because the delta G0 of formation of an element is 0 in its standard state. So oxygen gas is its standard state. Delta G0 formation of oxygen is 0. Make sure you remember that, because if you're doing a problem on a test and I didn't give you the delta G0 formation of some element, you're not going to know what to do if you don't remember that it's 0. So anyway, it ends up when you look up these numbers here, delta G0 formation of everything, there are these numbers here, plug them in, and this gives delta G0 of reaction as negative 1291 kilojoules. What does that tell us? Well, it tells us that under standard conditions, this reaction is spontaneous in the direction written. Remember, for a reaction to be spontaneous, delta G0 has to be less than 0, negative. Now, under most conditions are not standard conditions. That's kind of like a rare situation. It's not delta G0, but rather delta G that determines whether a process is spontaneous or not. And there, most of the time, those are different. So now, these delta Gs certainly depend upon temperature. And when you calculate delta G0, if you get a large negative value like we did for the combustion of methane, that tells you that the products are favored under standard conditions. And if it's large positive value, then the reactants are favored under standard conditions. In other words, if you get a large delta G0 for a positive delta G0 for a reaction, that means that if you reverse the reaction, that direction, the opposite direction, will be spontaneous under the standard conditions. Now, it can be shown that. We don't show that in this class. It's just a little bit beyond the scope of this class. But it can be shown that the relationship between delta G and delta G0 is that delta G is equal to delta G0 plus RT ln of Q, where R is 8.314 joules per Kelvin mole, T is the temperature in Kelvin, and Q is our friend, the reaction quotient from before. Remember, Q looks just like K, except that it's not necessarily at equilibrium. Memorize this equation. We're going to see a couple forms of it. It's very useful. For example, for the combination of hydrogen gas and iodine gas to form hydrogen iodide, it ends up, when you look it up, the delta G0 of formation. This is the, by the way, the equation for the formation of this with twice 2 moles of it. Anyway, delta G0 for this reaction, we looked it up. It's 2.60 kilojoules per mole. Q is, you know, just like K, it's products over reactants raised to the powers of their coefficients, and in this case it's going to be in atmospheres. So the partial pressure of hydrogen iodide squared over partial pressure of hydrogen times partial pressure of iodine. And now, okay, so because delta G equals delta G zero plus RTL and Q, delta G zero is positive, right? So if we didn't have this term here, if delta G was equal to delta G zero, this would not be spontaneous as written. But because Q can be either negative or positive, depending upon the relative values of the numerator and the denominator, right? If this quotient is less than one, Q will be negative, and if it's if the temperature is high enough and it's big enough negatively, then it can overpower this positive 2.60 kilojoules per mole and make delta G negative, which would make this spontaneous. So let's see. So at 25 Celsius, let's say the partial pressure of hydrogen iodide was one atmosphere, but the partial pressures of hydrogen and iodine were three atmospheres. Then plugging in into delta G equals delta G zero plus RTL and Q, there's delta G zero. Notice we're given delta G zero in kilojoules per mole, but because R has joules per Kelvin mole in it, I converted the kilojoules here to joules just by changing it to times 10 to the third. RT, Q is partial pressure of hydrogen iodide squared over partial pressure of hydrogen times the partial pressure of iodine. Plug these numbers in and check me, make sure I did my math correctly. But I believe we get negative 2.84 times 10 to the third joules per mole, or negative 2.84 kilojoules per mole. Now that's spontaneous under those conditions at 25 Celsius and with these partial pressures. Now at equilibrium, that's when Q is equal to K, and equilibrium means delta G is equal to zero. So we can say zero equals delta G zero plus RTL and K. Rearranging a little bit, we got delta G zero equals negative RT ln K. Look right there. We have a relationship between delta G zero and our equilibrium constant. Okay. Also, we can say, because we know delta G is delta H minus T delta S, so delta G zero is delta H zero minus T delta S. That's still equal to negative RT ln of K. Rearranging a little bit, we can get this equation here. This is nice. This equation here is in the form of a straight line, where ln of k would be y, the slope m would be negative delta h0 over r, x would be 1 over the temperature in Kelvin, and y would be delta s0 over r. So this means if you make a plot of the natural log of k versus 1 over the temperature in Kelvin, get the best fit straight line. The slope of that fit straight line will be negative delta H0 over R. So that means you can get delta H0 just by multiplying the slope by negative negative R. And the y-intercept is delta S0 over R, so you can get the delta S0 by multiplying the y-intercept by R. Remember, R is 8.314 joules per Kelvin mole. All right, so that's really useful. You should memorize this stuff right here. You use it for sure. Now, finally, why is it called free energy? Because it's energy that's not because it's energy that doesn't cost money. No, it's because it's energy that's available free to do work. As a matter of fact, the maximum amount of work possible that can be done from a process at constant temperature and pressure is equal to delta G. But that's theoretical. In any real process, you will never be able to get this amount of work out from that process, because some of that free energy goes into not work, but rather it's lost as, you know, dissipation as energy, you know, friction, things like that. But this gives you an upper limit on the amount of work that you can do from the free energy from a process.